Well, how about you with recession? Well, they say we're pulling out of recession now. Looks like it's the best holiday season ever. Recession? Recession? Buddy, someone has been neglecting your education. Recession is in your mind. Recession is in your mind. I mean, you can have it if you want to. It's a bit like giving up, isn't it? Some argue that it is also a knee-jerk trend of certain extremely wealthy factions at any given time to precipitate tight money to increase the spending power of their existent wealth. But you don't have to be a part of that. Were that to be the case, and who knows, then it's even more shameful for the average person because it becomes an indictment against them for having succumbed to some sort of prevalent mind control program smacking of Big Brother scenarios. Regardless, I would submit that disenthrallment is one of the myriad prices of freedom. As the late Soviet Union may have noted on their way out, to control the people is to deny them the potential of economic viability. Others maintain that it's a problem of mass psychology, an aberration in the public psyche that causes economic panic in regular waves throughout the passage of history. It is curious to note that oft times, lack of stability in the market seems to indicate that a multitude of investors are mentally ill. One form of this mental illness of which we are talking is the mental illness of compulsive gambling. It is when the victim becomes obsessed with not realistic success, but rather the resultant hormonal cocktail in the brain that results from the thrill of winning and taking risks. I mean, heck, even if they lose, they get the thrill. They're addicted to it. It's a drug. What's wrong with that? Ask any professional gambler. At best, he or she must be content with little beggar. Yeah, that's it, man. You better be content with little beggar if you're going to be a winner and loser like that. At best, he or she can be content with little better than breaking even. Everyone else who gambles compulsively, you know, we're talking about everyone else who's not a professional gambler. Everyone else who gambles compulsively will lose big time in order to get that infrequent thrill of an actual win. You know, professional gambling, huh? They're the ones that seems you gotta know when to hold. You gotta know when to fold. Know when to walk away. Know when to run. You don't count no money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting. And when the dealing's done. Yep. Irresponsibility and self-centeredness are both symptoms of the mentally ill. One day they are Dr. Jekyll, and the next, at the report of the slightest difficulty, they break down and become Mr. Hyde. This in itself is a potential cause for economic disaster, since that majority of investors that have incurred mental illness becoming obsessed with the self-centered penchant to merely acquire wealth will also paradoxically become economically incompetent due to being mentally handicapped and therefore be incapable of responsible investing. So those are two situations. Concerning these two things, they'll always be there in one form or another. And any economy in history must always succeed in spite of them. In spite of them. Or else, what? Or else they lose mercantile freedom, are overrun by dictatorship. And that has happened regularly in history. Another topic for another article. Those who seek to exercise control of others can be found from the most esoteric of workplaces to the highest pinnacles of power, economic or otherwise. No need to disturb them. No need to disturb them. They are now sequestered into the mystery of history. No prosperity need affect them to the adverse, because what they have is merely that which is acknowledged by that humanity which they have in their sway. The reality of true economics is far beyond this type of arena and is as constant as universal physics. Wherever its principles are applied and by whomever, true economics will prosper and incur prosperity. It is simply a plutocracy of those with enough presence of mind to see a need and fill it that will, in the final analysis, determine the prosperity of a body politic. But as concerning the mentally ill, they require compassion and support, or else their condition will gradually become less and less treatable. Of course, the danger is that from their ranks emerge the criminally insane. And among these, those with demented wisdom, the demented wisdom to become perpetrators of so-called legal crimes and also white-collar crime on a smaller scale. But all share in one common aspect, legally or otherwise, they are not guilty of their acts being insane. That having been said, they must not be allowed to bring down global economies. Therefore, a robust economy must be able to succeed independent of them, as well as of the others. Let the unfortunate victims remain confined in their padded cells, such as the New York Stock Exchange, the DAX, the All Ordinaries, the Hang Seng, and so on and so forth. where they can gamble away their livelihoods on dinosaurs that can be $65 a share one day and 35 cents the next, for lack of marrying a portable digital camera with a printer. True economics is like sunlight. In fact, energy, often in the form of sunlight, is the economic unit of the ecosystem. The flow of economics is always there, in any given situation. And that flow can often be defined by currency, either national or spurious. That's why businesses exist in the first place. They perform a function that has been initially defined in currency projection by business plans, recorded or inferred, and subsequently defined by the pecuniary transactions of patronage. True economic flow is not the mere currency that is simply the convenience that measures values in transactions, but rather, true economic flow is the ever-present condition in any location of needed effort or endeavor. That's why most of these leviathans of the past are not true economic engines, but rather economic illusions to be followed by the visionless. Here in the second, third, and fourth quarters of 2001, that's when I wrote this article, that was the recession back then, many huge concerns had extensive assets in the form of human potential they could channel into whatever it was, wherever it was needed, whatever was needed, wherever it was needed. And those assets were in the form of large volumes of established, trained, and loyal employees. And what do they do? What did they do? They downsized. They downsized. And worse, they therefore received congratulations, praise, and the accolades of the sophists of the business world. Absolutely, totally pathetic. Who put those people in charge? Instead of channeling the one asset they truly have, human endeavor, into the needs of the day, which they never bother to perceive, they rid themselves of the one faction of their concerns that was of any true value. Their problem was not in the size of their workforce. Their problem was in lack of enterprise. It's like throwing passengers one by one off a moving sled to keep the wolves from boarding it. Today's band-aid is tomorrow's failure. A little patch on a festering wound will guarantee future amputation. Man, you better check your triage. What they need to do is get rid of those big expensive buildings and keep the personnel. When times get tough, expand the R&D and get rid of the building fund. That's the problem with the college guys. They learned the past. History is useful for perceiving the future, but not by amassing huge chunks of that knowledge in such large quantities all in one 8-year sitting that is forgotten as soon as the final exams are passed. Realizing how useless that kind of expensive knowledge is, most sensible businesses employ those graduates not on the basis of what they have learned, but on how adept they are at being able to find things out. True knowledge is gained by an ongoing combination of both learning and experience. In the last article I wrote before this one, I covered the problem with decentralization. You want to read that? It's paulhallart.com. Click the economics button. Go to articles. They're not the articles of war. They're the articles of wear out or wherever. Anyway, in this article I'm covering here, the chain reaction of decentralization and how that benefits electronics, tech industries, durable goods, automotive products, and so on and so forth. Don't get me wrong, I'm all for rebuilding New York. This is like 2001, I guess. You remember that? 9/11. Don't get me wrong, I'm all for rebuilding New York City, just as long as it gets shared with other states from Manhattan and New York to Nebraska. You see what I'm saying? New York City, if you really want it to work, has got to extend to Nebraska. A city that runs laterally for 1,000 miles or more. If you want to build it right this time, you build it along the road. If they want to build it right this time, they should build it along the road. They almost got it right in the East Coast megalopolis from Washington to Boston, but the part they got wrong was the huge and opulent city centers with their skyscrapers scattered in the midst of the slums that fed such disproportionate wealth in the first place. One of the greatest elements of prosperity was not some little economic travesty in the middle of some big honking city, man. One of the greatest elements of prosperity was the interstate highway system. But they are running east and west and north and south. It was the wrong direction that choked the prosperity of the central United States. They needed to run diagonally. Ouch. They needed to run diagonally. This would make them a crossroads. This would make of them the crossroad effect that is so vital to economic engines, like cross-hatching on a print. Yeah, you know, you ever heard of cross-hatching? It's used mostly in, well, the days of when they made prints, you know, like lithography or etchings. It's funny, you know. This one's so cheap. You probably get a copy of this print anywhere. It's easy. You check it out for yourself. You know, it's like gone from the gold standard to the paper standard here. Now it's the electronic standard. So I'm going to have to upload this, you know, at the Wi-Fi with a cup of drip coffee, and I'm using the electronic standard. See that little iron oxide there. Yeah, it's rust. And that's probably going to change.
The electronic standard, swipe my card, man.
This is a gift card.
Hey, I made it to Amex. Got it at the drugstore. Look at the cat drugged in, man. The cat drugged in.
Beam me aboard, Scotty. There was no human intelligent life here, not even a human. Ow, that was a 2x4. Beam me aboard, Scotty. Whoosh, missed. Ow, my nose. Wallet to wall wallet. Okay, let's see. So you, on this print, you can see, you may not be able to see it in the picture on the cam, but you'll be able to look, and it's where it's called graphics in the art field. You take a pen, your pen or your line, and you cross it diagonally. And the line drawn with the pen, or in this case with the metal etching, what they did is they scored a piece of plastic and then would etch it with acid, and then that would make about 1,000 prints later on without wearing out. The ultimate thing was doing it, doing this etching on a with a kind of a crayon on a smooth stone. That was called lithography, as in lithic, you know, stone. So that makes sense. Litho, they're stoned. They're stoned on money, man. Stoned on cash. Okay, so there's the drawing is called a hatch. It's not like when an egg hatches. This is a hatch of a pen. Make a hatch. When they cross like that, you get a gray effect. And using the cross hatch was used a lot in printing. And you can see an example like that. Just check here. Most of your money system has a cross hatching on it. And that's an example of taking the highway system and making it into an engine that produces economic viability for any given populace. Actually, I call that, if you can actually build it on purpose, I call that economic engineering. By running east and west, the highway system in north and south, it was it still brought prosperity, but not the optimum prosperity. It's like when you build the engine, it's got to run right. It has to be designed according to physics. This is economic physics. They needed to go diagonally. This would make of them the crossroads effect that is so vital to economic engines. Like cross-hatching on a print, they would hatch equally across the mainland. And at every cross-hatch of interstate crossroads, there would be the potential of a successful metropolis. I mean, you know, you've got a few cities now. You know, you check San Diego, for example. It's supposed to be a big city. Then that place is a little slum somewhere in the middle of nowhere. I mean, if you connect San Diego with New York, across the whole continent of the United States, and you connect Miami with Seattle, right where they conjunct, you're going to have Puta Manuta, the biggest honking city on the planet, interlaced between the farms. It's like East St. Louis. Not the East St. Louis that's there, but further out. Okay. Like cross-hatching on a print, they would equally cross the mainland. And at every cross-hatch of interstate crossroads, there would be the potential of a successful metropolis. That handy word, I got that from reading Superman comics. Hey, see, I tell you, that works. You know, you're not going to pick that kind of stuff up in your 8-year amassment of knowledge. If you did, you wouldn't have had a global recession where $43 trillion was lost. Now, if you did this right, you lost $43 trillion, nobody would notice it because it would be so minuscule, because you would have By that time, a global economy of easily 500 dekillion. Man, 43 trillion, eat my dust. Come on, man. Let's start getting realistic here. Okay, so take the structure of city systems in the continental U.S. today. Okay, city systems, and multiply it by the available territory, systems, territory, times territory, and you have the ingredients for exponential growth. You can actually calculate it. Cities times territory equals growth. That's why I'm quoting 500 dekillion here. But you know, if somebody wants to precipitate a recession, let them, leave them alone. They're the blind leading the blind. They ditched themselves. They're gone. We let them have their stupid little idiotic New York Stock Exchange and gamble on their stocks. Leave them in their padded cell to rot. That's the Stone Age. They don't know economics. 43 trillion, okay. Oh, well, 43 trillion. Let them, hey, keep it, man. Keep it. It's a tip. What? Forget dekillion, man. How about let's go for quadro-dekillion? Huh? And some guy asked his little kid to come up with a name, you know, for a huge number because nobody knew. Nobody even bothered to look that far. The only way they can have a big number is to have an exponent off of the zeros. Six exponents make a million. Oh, big deal. So you're a millionaire? Whatever, man. That and a mobile home might give you 20 years retirement. I'll tell you. If the existent city areas were to have direct interstate limited access carriageway connection with its counterpart geographically opposite to themselves, the prosperity would be in place indefinitely, provided the infrastructure were properly maintained. We're not talking about these kind of rotten, decaying, falling apart road systems where the Republicans and the Democrats couldn't get along and get it done, accusing people of pork barrel. Oh, it's only an economic engine. Oh, that's supposed to be pork barrel, huh? It's so embarrassing when businesses downsize their operations just to please a skittish collection of gutless investors. Speculators are the ruin of any essential enterprise. As for you, the victims of their latest lack of professionalism, and I can tell you now, I wrote this 10 years ago, but it's happening again. Well, they say we're pulling out of it. Oh, you believe that? Huh? Well, it's like 5 years from now. Oh, well, looks like we're having a recession again. Better get over it. Yeah, sure. You go along with it, man. You'll be a part of the disaster. So as for you, the victims of their latest lack of professionalism, my sympathies are with you. We should hand them a replacement for their plastic flags. They said, yeah, they have it's these plastic little patriotic flags they wave.
Oh, jump on board. Yeah, I'm the patriot and I'm going to take you for all your work.
Yeah, all right. Let's replace those cute little plastic flags made in China. I mean, the last time I looked, that's what it said on the flag. these little plastic flags. We should hand them a replacement for their plastic flags. The black pirate's flag will do them. See, you don't have to have red, white, and blue. That's more expensive. Just give them a black flag. The black pirate's flag will do them. As it would all sunshine patriots. Don't worry, people. It's a good thing you got out of those companies. They didn't deserve you anyway. Let them panic and sink into the dinosaur tar pits.